Hey, this is Phil, and this is the Unionist Podcast. And in this episode, I had the good fortune to sit down and talk with the Associate Director of Education and Development for the International Brotherhood of Teamsters, Sally Payne. And I really hope you enjoy listening to it as much as I did talking to her. It's amazing.
I think is the miracle of the whole thing. Because they say things they would not normally ask.
Really?
Yeah.
All right. I'm going to give another chance.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, you need to.
Sally Payne.
Yes.
Welcome.
Thank you.
What was your title at the end? So here's the thing. Are you still working at the International? Yes.
Yes.
And your title is what?
My title is Associate Director. Of the Training and Development Department. The department changed its name when Mr. Hoffa came in, and it went from Education to Training and Development. And I'll explain a little bit about why that happened. But yeah, I started in, I think it was...
When did you start?
1979. Yeah.
That's going back a ways.
Yeah, a long, long way. And my memory of a lot of it is probably not that great, but... I have to say, there's not one minute that I regret.
Oh, that's amazing.
Yeah, it was just...
So how many years is that? That's
It'll be 44. Well, it was 44 in March 30th.
March 30th, 44 years.
Mm-hmm.
And so when you started, was that physically at the building in D.C.?
Or? Yes.
Oh, okay.
Yes. I had...
How did you get there?
Okay. That's a good question. I had started when I moved to what my ex-husband is a geographer. And he worked at the U.S. Geological Survey in Washington, D.C. So that's how I ended up in Washington. But I always wanted to teach because I had received my teaching degree.
Oh, okay. You were going to be a teacher.
Yeah, I was going to be a teacher. And at that time, they weren't hiring a lot of teachers. So it was like, I was like, oh, geez, what am I going to do? I really want to teach. And a friend of mine who worked for the American Federation of Government Employees, AFGE, mm-hmm. called me and she goes, Sally, we have a job and I think you'd be great. And I said, oh, is it teaching? And she goes, no, it's research. And I was like, research? And she said, yeah, but you can get in, do the research. And she said, I think you can start doing some training.
Right. Well, and you get in and you make things, you know, things happen, right?
Right.
Life happens.
So I decided, okay. Well, the reality of back of that is it was a great decision because by being in research, I had to research.
Oh.
I had to do all kinds.
Well, what kind of – so at AFGE, back in – so when is this?
This was before Jennifer was born, my daughter. So it was back in 1970. 76? I think I worked there 5 years. So it had to be 76.
Gotcha.
No, 75.
Yeah.
So anyway –
So what were you researching?
Bills for Congress.
Oh.
Yeah. Writing.
Because you're right there. You're in D.C.
Yeah. And I was writing legislation and sending it to the general president. His name was Clyde Weber. And I would give him my writing and I'd sit down with him and he'd go over everything and goes, no, we can't say this or yeah, we can say that.
Oh, my gosh. That's awesome.
It was so awesome. And I remember one of the research things I did that I'll never forget was for the federal government. Meat inspectors.
Okay.
And that left a lasting impression on me because those folks literally, their job, I can't even
describe. When was that? When was like Upton Sinclair in the jungle and...
Yeah, that was before. That was like in the 1950s, I want to say.
Right.
So this was like way before. I mean, what I was doing was way after that. But when I read... the information about what they had to go through, these meat inspectors, I couldn't eat meat for years.
Oh my goodness. Being a meat inspector, I gotta find a meat inspector to talk to. That'd be wild.
And then the conditions that they worked under. I mean, it was just horrible. But anyway, I by doing research and writing those bills and all of that kind of thing, it gave me such a great background. Because prior to that, I was just a member of my union, which was the teachers' union.
Oh, okay.
And so that's I had been in the union. My dad had been in the union. So we kind of were a union family.
Well, that's the thing. So how – yeah. I mean, it's definitely – union families are the thing because I'm a product of a union family too. So, you know, it's kind of something that passes along, which was funny because I had spent, you know, the better part of my youth, you know, pushing against it.
Right. And when my dad, it's such a weird story because nobody in North Carolina went to college, especially girls. Okay. Back then.
Right.
And my father looked at me when I was in high school and he said, "You have no choice." He said, "You're going to college." And the reason he did that is he had to drop out of high school. It was during the Depression.
Okay, yeah.
And so he was like, he understood how important education was. And for a girl back then, it was like, whoa. But he told me, he said, "When you go to school," he said, "you're going to be working for me." And he said, "And if you don't bring home A's, I'm going to fire you."
Oh, nice. So that's a really interesting way to frame it.
Yeah.
Can I use that?
Yes.
Because my kids are potato heads.
But he paid for everything. So he told me, he said, "I don't want you working while you're going to school. I want you to go to school."
That was your job.
That was my job. And I loved that theory because, young kids today end up going to college and they're in debt so much.
I know. It's crazy.
That they can't.
And that's the way for working families, for middle, lower class people, that's the way out is education, to get to the next level.
Definitely for me it was. And the fact that he pushed me like that, I was resentful at the time.
Did any brothers and sisters?
I had my older sister and she went for 1 year, dropped out and got married.
Oh,
and
okay.
See, my dad told me, he said, if you get married, you're done.
Yeah, yeah.
He said, you're done. So I did my four years.
God bless your dad.
No. And I got my degree and I was like, thank God. I look back on it and I'm like, thank God he did that.
What was his name?
His name was Jennings.
Jennings
Parker.
Oh, wow. That's very North Carolina-y.
Very English, yeah. British.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. And he was in construction. And he told me, if you ever pick up a tool, I will shoot you. He said, "This is the
Isn't
heart."
That funny? How we do that? Don't grow up to be like me.
No.
You know?
He said, "This is the hardest job," and he said, "I don't want you to ever have to work like this." And then when I graduated, and he said, "I don't care what you do." He said, "You do what you want to do." He said, "But you will be in the union."
Wow. He said, that was it.
Yeah.
So
I said, I'm a teacher. So I said, okay, I'll be in the teachers' union. He said, okay. But when I graduated from East Carolina University in North Carolina, and when we graduated, they took us in a room and set all of us down, and they told us that we were professionals.
Okay.
And that professionals don't join labor unions.
Oh.
And so I was sitting there listening to this, and I could feel the heat rising up into my face.
Right.
Because I was getting furious. And so I just raised my hand and I said, "Teachers are getting about 1% pay increase per year. There's nothing professional about it." I said, why would we not want to have a voice?
Oh, really? You threw down right there.
Right there.
Where you're graduating to.
Yeah. I'd already burned that bridge. Yeah, I'd already passed everything, so they couldn't do anything. But it was like, it was so shocking to me. But now looking back on it, for North Carolina, it's par for the course.
I miss that fire. I don't know. I'm getting older too. And it's like the fire of really not caring.
Yes.
You could just give a shit about getting in somebody's face about right or wrong, really.
Yeah. And I think that
did you see the that young girl in Texas, her valedictorian speech.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Wasn't that great?
Wasn't that great? And they threatened to like hold her degree. And yeah, she really stuck it to them.
Talk about freedom of speech.
Right.
I mean, come on. We got to let people say, especially young people. Like I'm watching my grandsons now and they're all so socially conscious and they're so involved in politics and what's going on.
Oh, you must
on.
Be so proud.
Oh, it's just wonderful. I couldn't ask for anything better. I mean, they're just so different than what I grew up around. Because I have to tell people, and we just did a wonderful diversity training, and Raven Hall, one of the attorneys from the IBT.
Okay.
Did
Shout
it.
Out to Raven.
Yeah. Yeah, she's really great. She did the training. It was mainly about implicit bias and how we don't even know sometimes the biases that we're holding, and they come out in odd ways. And I told her, I said, being from North Carolina, I've seen the worst of the worst.
I would imagine. Jeez.
And so I am very, very cautious about trying to be aware of that inborn or whatever you want to call it bias.
Right.
So it's like the water fountains. I remember as a little girl asking my mother,
oh my God, yeah.
What is this about? And my mother,
you were right there in the middle of it, all of it as a young girl and as a,
yeah, it was like horrible. But it wasn't, I mean, it was horrible.
So you probably graduated high school, what, like 72?
66 high school.
Oh, 66 high school.
70 university.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
Oh, so yeah, you were right in the thick of it.
Yeah. Yeah. Right in the 60s. And my ex-husband and I had all the.
And the civil rights movement and everything. Yeah.
On campus. And he was in ROTC, so he felt weird participating in a lot of the demonstrations.
Of course, yeah.
And rallies and stuff, but I certainly didn't feel odd about it.
You were all over it.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, even in North Carolina, you know, we had a lot of demonstrations. We had a lot of very interesting speakers that would come to the university, and so
what a crazy time, you know, cuz the whole country was kind of maturing, I guess, is
right. That was
but it was hard.
That was the first time I had real conflict with my father.
Oh, okay.
Because he, you know, it was a big shift in everything.
Right, 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 right.
And he was still, you know, a little bit mired in that old, good old boy network thing. Although he had two daughters. So it was like he got stuck.
Yeah, he didn't have a choice.
Yeah. My mom, on the other hand, was never like that. My mother was very, very, she loved everyone. She's told me something that has stayed with me all my life. She said, Sally, you take every single person that comes to you as that person.
Right.
Don't make a judgment until you've had an opportunity to understand and talk to that person.
Well, what's crazy is, and I finished high school in a small town, and it was very white. And I mean, for lack of a better term, it was very white. And sometimes people think you're, you know, because you're white, you're like part of the crowd, and you hear the way some people talk about other people, and it just makes you sick.
It does.
Yeah.
It does. The whole thing, although the beauty of being in the university during that time is that everything was challenged. Everything.
Right.
All of your points.
Oh my gosh. And you got Vietnam going on, just starting to really get bad. Yeah.
Questioning whether our country is really in it for the right reasons and why were we there. And, you know, we had been taught, I'd been brought.
Gosh, I forget but you've got civil rights movement, you've got Vietnam. I mean.
And the odd thing is the women's movement really didn't happen at that point. You know, it was later.
Right.
And it was mainly civil rights movement and the Vietnam War.
You can you can get a little closer, too, if you can.
Okay.
It just sounds better.
All right. Let me see if I do it this way, if it's better.
And I'm going to say edit because I go through transcript. But anyway, so yeah.
So, you know, it was just those two big movements. But my father was upset with me because he thought I should be focusing on my education. And he was worried that I was being distracted.
Yeah. Well, but that's...
It was an education. That was an education.
Right.
I mean, it really was.
That's being in your 20s, you know.
Yeah. Yeah. Then when I got to AFGE, American Federation...
I didn't even think... You know, it's funny until you mentioned it. I didn't even think, of course, meat inspectors are union.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. Yeah, they
all federal meat inspectors,
all the federal employees. So every time we have a shutdown of the government or whatever, all those people, it's just like our members, when we have a lockout or a strike or whatever, they're out of work for a while.
Right.
Now the
stupid government shutdowns.
The federal employees couldn't strike.
Right.
Although I used to tell them, you know, historically all groups have not been able to strike. So
Well, you can strike but not strike.
Yeah. And the postal workers actually did strike. In 1970, they went on strike. And the reason they won was they were able to go door to door and talk to people.
Oh, my God. They had everybody covered.
They had everybody on their side back then. Now, I don't think it would be as successful.
But I don't know, man. Boy, people really have been.